Latin America's youth, here represented by global shapers, women, and its larger and more demanding middle class are cornerstones to drive positive change in Latin America. By bringing together prominent and dynamic leaders from so many different backgrounds, this meeting provides an ideal platform for committed decision makers to set a bold renovation agenda and to take the initiative on a new generation of public-private cooperation and transformational projects. We hope this unparalleled opportunity for multi-stakeholders dialogue will influence the future course of the region through our renovation agenda. And it's now my pleasure to introduce to you the President of Mexico, Mr. Enrique Peña Nieto. Mr. President.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning to each and all of you. I would like to say hello to Mr. Klaus Schwab, who is the president of the World Economic Forum. And as I've said to him privately, it's a great honor and distinction for Mexico to be the host of this 10th meeting of the WEF for Latin America and the Caribbean. Undoubtedly, a great opportunity also for Mexico to share with you its experience on the road to structural changes, structural reforms that have been of notable importance to Mexico. I would like to welcome the President of Panama and the President of Haiti. Your presence here distinguishes us, sirs. It's an honor to have you here amongst us. Distinguished guests at this meeting representing governments, enterprises, academics, analysts, and those who are truly interested in this Latin American and Caribbean region, representatives of the media, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to you all, to Mexico, a mega diverse nation that is proud of having a culture that is measured in millennia. We Mexicans are a warm and hospitable society. We are the friend of all nations in the world, and that's why it's an honor for my country to welcome the World Economic Forum on Latin America for the third time since its founding. This has been a privileged space for constructive dialogue in which strategic topics are discussed for development of our region. Latin America has been a territory of utopia and of action. It has been a land of hope in which great feats have been undertaken in favor of the most precious of ideals, the likes of liberty and justice. Nobel laureate Octavio Paz asserted that America is not so much a tradition, but continuing like a future to be undertaken. Project and utopia are inseparable from Hispano-American thought. In Latin America and the Caribbean, we continue to be inspired by feats of the freedom fighters such as Toussaint Louverture, Miguel Hidalgo, Simon Bolivar, and Antonio José Le Sucre. Here also we saw revolutions of great social content that were inspired by the desire for greater equality. In this beginning of the 21st century, Latin America continues its march to consolidate itself as an inclusive, democratic, and progressive region. Our countries are investing in education and knowledge because we know that the main asset of our people are our young people. Latin American societies value their history, but they also have their sights set on the future. We are nations that are dynamic and plural, increasingly open to the world, willing to compete and be triumphant in global markets. In this new stage, we have created plans of regional integration, such as the Community of Latin American and Caribbean States, or sub-regional plans, such as the innovative, novel Pacific Alliance that promotes a free movement of people, goods, and capitals between Chile, Colombia, Peru, and Mexico. In Latin America, there is a spirit of transformation and modernity to foster economic growth and development of our societies. And that's why I'm so happy that the World Economic Forum has proposed the topic for this plenary, advancing through an agenda of renovation, just like in Latin America, Mexico is also renewing itself. It is transforming itself. Our economy has solid foundations, is the second largest of the region and one of the most open economies in the world. We have free trade agreements with 45 countries that gives us access to a potential market of over 1,100,000,000 consumers, and the great majority of our exports are manufacturing exports, and they are increasingly sophisticated. For instance, Mexico is the number one exporter of flat screens and refrigerators, and we're the number fourth exporter of vehicles in the world, and we are moving forward firmly in the aerospace sector. We are a nation of young people, trained young people, and talented young people. 50%, half of our population is aged 27 years and younger, and every year 100,000 engineers and technologists are graduating from our schools. In addition, we are consolidating ourselves as a tourism powerhouse. In 2014, our country once again was amongst the 10 most visited countries in the world. The World Economic Forum has recognized the advance in its competitive index in terms of travel and tourism, in which we have increased our ranking by 14 positions in just a year. To better take advantage of these strengths, we have undertaken a great transformation, a deep transformation over the past 2 years, and based on a great national agreement with the main political party forces in the country, we've been able to undertake structural reforms, such as the educational reform, reforms that strengthen our institutional regime, such as the political electoral reform and the transparency reform that broadens accountability. And particularly, these are reforms that enhance productivity and competitiveness of our economy, such as the labor reform, the economic competition reform, the telecommunications reform, the finance, tax, and energy reforms. Each of these has done away with barriers and puts a fundamental sphere of our social and economic life at the vanguard. The reforms are the foundations for building a better country. They are a platform so that Mexico can begin a new stage of development. In its entirety, the transforming reforms will enable us to become a nation that is more prosperous and inclusive. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a Mexico in transformation. And it's this Mexico that welcomes you with open arms. I am sure that this forum will enable us to exchange ideas to accelerate and deepen the changes that are already underway in the region. I'm referring to strategies to foster greater productive integration, to develop infrastructure, and to renew our energy sector, the same as to foster research and development. But especially, I hope that this will be a space for constructive meetings amongst business persons and social leaders of the region, because you are, at the end of the day, those who bring us together and who bring our societies together and closer as well. So I wish you the best success and hope that you and this World Economic Forum Latin America can have a great effect in favor of the societies of Latin America and the Caribbean. Thank you very much.
I'm now honored to introduce our founder and executive chairman, Professor Klaus Schwab, and our distinguished panel of speakers, Mr. Michel Martelly, president of Haiti, Mr. Enrique Peña Nieto, President of Mexico, and Mr. Juan Carlos Varela, the President of Panama. Professor Schwab, the floor is yours.
Mr. President, I think first I have to adapt to the dynamic atmosphere of this country, of what we feel here in this audience, and I have to take off my tie.
In Cancun.
To really adapt to the dynamic spirit. Thank you for providing again the hospitality. It's our third meeting here in this country. It's our 10th Latin American Economic Summit. I think the record participation shows you the confidence which is given to the region and particularly also to the host country. I would, listening to you and all the comprehensive reforms you have undertaken, which have got a lot of attention around the world, because Mexico is considered now as one of those countries which has the willingness and the capability to reform itself. But Mr. President, when, and I would ask, start with you and afterwards ask the same questions to President Rodríguez and President Martelly. When you come to the end of your presidency, what would you like to be really the legacy which is attached to your name and which people will speak about still a century from now? What is the legacy? What is the vision really behind everything?
Gracias, Senator Schwab.
Mr. Schwab, thank you very much. I base myself on the conviction that a country is not built in a short period of time. I start from the idea that a country cannot be defined by a six-year administrative term in office, which is the governmental term in office for presidents in my country. I'm convinced that all of the generations that have come before us have done their best effort to help our country in its development. And I believe that the government has met the challenges of the country and has kept its promises and pledges to society. But what I've seen is the consistency between what I offered to Mexicans when I was campaigning in terms of what we've done. I believe, in other words, that we have done what we promised. And I think that the greatest contribution during my administration could be to make an important contribution so that based on the new foundations, the new mechanisms and means, such as the structural reforms that we've built all together, and here I could not, I would be remiss were I not to refer to all of the political forces in a democratic way and the way that we have worked democratically to build this, that this infrastructure work that we're fostering throughout the country with public-private partnerships, such as innovation and different public policies, leaving aside the policies that today seem were obsolete or that were no longer meeting the need that they were developed for. And these are the things that can be done so that Mexico can continue to grow and to have greater development, and the most importantly, for that legacy to have greater prosperity for Mexican society. These are the reference points, so structural changes, novel policies, and or significant infrastructure development will be, I believe, the greatest legacy and the greatest work that we can do in favor of the prosperity and development of Mexico.
So it's not just the legislation, it's the institutions, and it's probably also the mindset which has to change to adapt to our new world, which is so fast changing. I may come back to this point, but President Martelly, last year you were still presidential candidate when we had our meeting in your country. You came to Davos. You spoke about the need of reforms in your country. And I have to say congratulations, because you are one of the stars in terms of economic growth at the moment in the world. If I'm not mistaken, over 6%. But what do you still need reforms with such a high growth rate?
Muchas gracias, Professor Schwab, Presidente Enrique.
Thank you very much, Professor Schwab. President Enrique Peña Nieto, thank you very much for your hospitality and welcoming comments. For me, the success of Panama has been that it has had for 25 years democratic stability. When democracy is exercised to serve the public, it brings great benefits to the majority and to the entire population. In terms of the legacy that I'd like to leave as president, I think for me, the most important thing is to be able to change the policy, like in the majority of all of our countries, the services and products. We need to be able to have an impact through this way amongst people. We need to have a democracy that is participative with the separation of state from all other spheres, and that the public policies be focused on the areas that most affect the population. Countries that make mistakes, sometimes they have, there are attacks on the president in terms of what the president is developing in policy as if it were the president that it brings all of the problems. We need to have institutions that guarantee a democratic system. We need to have the education and healthcare systems so that we can inspire a new generation of men and women who see public life as a common good for everyone. And I would find that as a personal satisfaction to have served people in my vocation. And I think that we are achieving that legacy. We are being able to see many people come into public side and to focus their lives on having an impact on the lives of citizens in the country. I think that a public structure is so very important. When countries such as mine have sustained growth like 6 or 7 years for 10 years almost, it's very important to look at how you invest the public money, and though there is a greater social yield that's a great impact for people in terms of state policies and infrastructure and change the state from a business to a service, and have people take part in public service in such a way that it affects the greatest number of people, and to have prevention policies, for instance, for security, so that in all quarters of the country, even in quarters where there's low income and where it's danger, where they feel a great presence of the state, and so that they have services on education and healthcare, so that people can have a healthy life. And I think this is key for Latin American countries, for political forces to debate state policies and then turn them into reality, and leaving electoral issues to one side. I've always thought that it's policy in Latin America focused on soccer, where they focus on their club for 3 or 4 years, and then they work on their country for 6 months when there's the World Cup. In public policy, sometimes we want to do the same thing, but we have to do the opposite. We have to work on the country for 3 or 4 years and on internal matters only for 6 months. I think the political force needs to be able to focus that. We need to focus on the problems that affect the population. And in closing, I would just have a question. When the Summit of the Americas, which was a great success for the country, to be able to bring all Latin American countries together and American countries together to be able to focus on how to deal with insecurity and inequity, The reporters asked me, what is your country going to take from this summit? And I said, well, we're going to continue to be fighting for Panama, to have the Panamanian cap on our heads, and to deal with the issues that affect our population most substantially.
Thank you, Mr. President. In this context, you speak about all Latin America. I just would like to say how appreciative we are to have a Cuban delegation for the first time participating in this event. Welcome.
As I was telling the professor and all participants, the hotel where you are has a great history. This is where CELAC, the Latin American and Caribbean community was founded here, with the heads of state in that case at that time, the president of Cuba and President Chavez of Venezuela was also there at that time. And 5 years later, I think this has been a great space of dialogue and debate for countries that have been able to approach and draw closer ties with the United States and Canada as a result.
Mr. President Martelly, your country was struck by a major disaster, and now you are in the middle of major reconstruction. What legacy do you imagine for the future? First of all, let me greet the Mexican President Peña Nieto and thank him for the organization of this forum and for the warm welcome that he gave the Asian delegation and myself. And I'd also like to greet and congratulate President Varela. And I congratulate him also for the Summit of the Americas that took place some 2 weeks ago. And I thank you also for inviting me, because this is my second participation in the World Economic Forum, which is always a pleasure for me. Haiti's situation is always particular. I came into power immediately after this earthquake that caused more than 300,000 deaths and that destroyed our country. But we must admit that way before the earthquake, the state had abandoned everything. Constructions were poorly done. We did not plan our development. We had no economic program. So once I took office, I found a state in ruins. It was already a big burden to move 1,500,000 people living under tents, and for them, it had become a habit not to pay rent, not to pay food, since everything was provided for free. But fortunately, we're able to rehouse all of these people, and tonight, today, instead of 1.5 million of people living under tents, we only have approximately 40,000, and in 3 years, that was a major effort. In terms of legacy, to me, I wanted to leave a state at the service of the population, which is why the National Palace that was destroyed was not reconstructed. We are focused on reconstructing the Haitian man. In this sense, we implemented a free education program. So today, all young Haitians have a right to education, and to encourage them to go to school, we also provided them with free transportation. And they go to school tuition-free and transportation-free. And we always talk about a youth policy, because Haiti must change completely. And it's only through adequate training of youth that we can do it. We have built some 12 professional schools or vocational school in 3 years. And it makes a difference between, since our independence in 1804 until I took my oath of office, we only had 17 vocational schools in Haiti. And in 3 years, we were able to build as many. And we believe that sustainable change must go through training, education, and empowerment, which is what we are doing. Vocational school and soccer fields and sports areas that are also part of education. It's not just a game. I hope we'll leave Haiti with a different image. A responsible state. The opposition talks about corruption, but today we have a responsible state. We have a 3.2 growth rate, which is a bit more than the region over 3 years. Some diseases have been eradicated. The rate of mortality, children who died before age 5, has been reduced by 44%, one of the best in the world. We're in the process of changing things in Haiti. It changes in our image. We already perceive differently. Tourism has increased by 20%. So establishing a state today at the service of the population to enable Haiti to be on the path of modernity and sustainable development is essential to me. Congratulations for this progress under some very difficult circumstances. Je veux être un petit peu plus... Oh.
To try to be always happy, but never to be satisfied. So my question to you would be, what are you particularly happy about in what you have achieved? Just one very particular issue. And what are you particularly unsatisfied not having achieved until now? Presidente.
I think really the most important source of satisfaction for Mexico, undoubtedly, is to have shown, and I'm not speaking in my own name, but as part of Mexican society, that through democracy, And in the situation that we have right now, being such a diverse, plural Mexico, has many different ways of looking at things, very different visions. And under this condition, that we would have been able to have a whole agenda of structural reforms which have been proposed over many, many decades, that we would have dared to make structural changes, which undoubtedly are going to lead the country to a better future, more economic development, better dynamism in our economy, and obviously better well-being for the Mexican people, that we were able to break with paradigms that we thought were impossible to change. For example, structural change in the field of energy sources, that we would have been able to have more competency in the area of telecommunications, for example, that we had decided to make such a relevant change in the field of education to ensure that the professors, that the teachers are better prepared, better trained, and thus can give a better quality education to our children, that we would have decided, for example, to change more than 34 different laws to have better sources of credit in our country. And obviously, economic, financial, solid approach through our different agencies. Before, the population really didn't have access to these sources. These are deep structural changes. They give us new foundations. They give us a new platform. And above all, I think the most important thing was our determination, and this is a source of satisfaction, to have achieved really these changes through these structural bases. Now, perhaps what has not left us completely complacent or satisfied to date, or at least a degree of satisfaction that you referred to. And we think that these reforms really, as soon as possible, will lead to tangible, important changes for the population. We know that everything changes. We try to edify a nation that decides to change, to undergo transformations. It's not from one day to the next. And we hope that all of these benefits stemming from these reforms will be felt by all as soon as possible. So once again, we obviously have lower costs in telephone service. We don't have to pay long-distance calls. And telephone service in general is more economical than in the past. It's a greater source of competition. And this certainly leads to the benefit of Mexican families. We've also seen how, for the very first time in our country, the price and really the rates for electricity, for power and light, have dropped. It used to be, at the beginning of each year, there was an increase in these rates domestically, in business establishments, for industry. The cost, really, of electricity is tapering off. There are other benefits as well. These aren't the only benefits, but these reforms certainly point to a higher level of productivity in our country and more economic dynamism or recovery. So once again, I think that while we are not fully satisfied with all of this, because I don't think we have really been satisfied with all these reforms, but we think as time goes on that we are going to feel the effects of these reforms on Mexican families, and it's in this direction that we're working. Thank you.
Mr. President, Peña Nieto, we should also not forget that all those reforms have to take place in an economic environment globally which is characterized by slower growth. And if you look at the IMF forecast, we will have quite for some years to come a relatively reduced global growth rate. Yeah. And I think this is, in terms of your export capabilities and so on, this has to be taken into consideration. President Varela, I was meeting the young generation yesterday. It's a tradition in the World Economic Forum that we have always a strong attention given to the expectations of the young generation. And I was asking the young generation, our young global leaders and our global shapers, as we call them, what is on the top of your list? And I think I would formulate it in the following way. The trust gap, the lack of trust in politicians, in systems, and of course it has to do also with the issue of governance, of corruption. What would you tell the young people in order what you are undertaking, and I will ask the other presidents later the same question, what are you undertaking in order to respond to those expectations for better governance? And we have the problem not only in Latin America, we have it globally. What is your response to the young children?
Well, for me, what's most important really right now is our capability, our capacity, and to be able to bring into the public eye professional, independent entrepreneurs, men and women, and that they stop in the middle of their life. I realize that this is an important consideration, but that they just put a hold on hold their family life, and that they really allow these young people to share the public life, the 20 years of experience that they have, and to put really of this at the service of young men and women who have taken a step in the right direction and who are ready to face the problems that affect the country. And they're helping me to comply with the government plan in education and health, energy, to see people from all the different political parties, independent public parties, and they're all focused really on one common goal. And in my particular case, I have four or five ministers who I met them at the very first interview that they made. Others were sometimes three interviews, maybe 3 or 4 hour interviews, academicians, professionals, entrepreneurs. We brought them all together. We brought all the talent of the country together. And I think we have seen good success stories in different fields of culture, academia, et cetera. And I think Panama really is capitalizing on this in our public life. And I think people have understood that the most important thing really is not to build parties, but rather to build a nation, to build a country, prosperity for all. And I think to have that whole pool of talent, in the case of the global leaders, where we see youth participating at the Summit of the Americas, et cetera, I think this has inspired them. They've seen a path they can go down in public life, not just economically, a matter of economic resources. We all want to move forward in our lives. But the satisfactions that can be derived from this and the number of people that we can have an impact on, to see the smiles on the face of children, to solve basic health problems, education, housing, and all the challenges that we've set forth for ourselves, especially trying to have secondary education for 100% of all of our youth. These are part of our social reforms. I think preventive medicine, for example, for everybody, massive transportation system in Panama City, for example. In 7 years, we're going to have some 400 kilometers of public transportation, or maybe even renew 60 kilometers. Why for public transportation? Because we have the technical resources at our disposal. We have the economic resources to be able to move forward with this agenda. The most complicated aspect for me is for people to get used to red tape, bureaucratic red tape, trying to figure out how long different works, public works are going to take for them to adapt to public life, to government. So I think this is difficult. For example, the bids are put out, but it can take years for them, these public works, to get in place. So once again, we want to have this as a vision of the state, and that we are going to continue to build, to construct on this basis in all of these different areas. I think this is the big challenge, is to inspire, to encourage our young people to work on the future of their country, undoubtedly working together with the private sector, including the private sector, especially in fields of education, where I think the private sector really can play a top-notch role. And I think the success or failure of a country is not just the government or not just up to the president. It's the whole country. It's all the people. So we have to bring in all of these different forces, civilians, labor unions, politicians, et cetera, and to have a model, to set an example for our young people. For me, this is very important. So once again, when we see politicians on television, sometimes I say to myself, how really can a teacher get things in order at the school when the children are looking at all of these programs? So I think we have to preach with our example. And this is very important to go down this path of public life. And once again, social responsibility for entrepreneurs, the commitment of our government. I think this is very important. And these are the challenges that we face in the future, especially for our youth. Thank you.
President Peña Nieto, how would you address this issue of highest governance principles and the lack of trust in governments? But I have to add, there's also a lack of trust in business leaders. We need the highest ethical principles everywhere. What is your response to the young generation?
Well, I think, first of all, that politics undoubtedly is the means by which we can encourage the transformation of a society. Unfortunately, sometimes the lack or the absence of seeing immediate results in a society such as ours, people expect immediate results, and they want to find a solution to the problems right away. So for governments, I think this is certainly a huge challenge to match their expectations, to be able to satisfy some of these social demands that is brought about by the sense of immediacy. So I think another major challenge that we face as governments is to become more efficient, to be more efficient in government management, good governance. I think this is important that we need to see throughout the government. And this good governance undoubtedly will help and will lead to principles that we can see will make a positive, a decisive contribution to transparency. And I think that certainly was part of your question. I would like to mention what I've been criticized for. Corruption certainly is a matter sometimes of cultural change. It's really the scourge of our societies, especially in Latin American societies. If we really want to achieve a change of mentality, of behavioral patterns, of practices, of assimilating new ethical and moral values, then this has to be a structural change throughout society. From the government's point of view, we have been the major, really, engine behind this to try to get other political forces to work in favor of transparency. And just recently, we have the secondary law for a constitutional amendment, which sets levels and practices which will lead to greater transparency throughout all of the different government agencies. It means that all of these public bodies that receives public resources must be transparent. And we are also having debates on reforms to set up an anti-corruption system. On the one hand, there would be better practices in governance or for governance, and on the other hand, mechanisms which would sanction any infringement of good practices. But I think the most important aspect, these are certain measures, they're instruments, they're ways which really add to what has already been established. If a society is not determined to change for the good and really to be part of a new culture in favor of legality, then these endeavors will simply not be enough. Because sometimes it turns out, and here perhaps there are some criticisms of a cultural basis, when we really have patterns, when we have behavioral patterns that should be followed. Some people want everybody else to follow them, but they don't always apply them to themselves. They think this should be a law for everybody else, but not for oneself. So in Mexico, there's a saying that says, make sure you apply laws to other people, but not in my home. So apply it to everybody else, but not to me. So on this topic, I think really is a scourge that penetrates the whole society. I think we see outbreaks here and there, and that have been pointed out as very poor practices. So I think if we really want to change this, then we have to be the governments behind this cultural change that will allow us really to knock down these walls that have been an obstacle in the past and that get in the way of moving forward, that will lead to more equality, more justice in our societies. Thank you.
I think your answer, Mr. President, shows us how committed you are to establish this new mindset, which is important in order to reform a society, and also how difficult it is. I mean, and how we should never forget it's a global problem, it's a global issue. Monsieur le Président, qu'est-ce que...
Let me begin by saying the lack of trust on the part of youth is due to the failure of certain state policies. For example, if we think about Haiti, a country where the unemployment rate is beyond 60%, and in education, in more than 85% of schools were private skill, how could you even think that the people could access such education? So we had to come up with this idea of creating trust by offering services to the population and provide access to education, for example. And that has to do with today's theme, innovation. We had to innovate to enable Haiti to pay for all these children's tuition, to enable them to go to school. And the way we did it was very simple. We began to collect 5 cents per incoming telephone calls, as well as $1.50 on all remittances to Haiti from the diaspora. And the combination of these collections have enabled us to pay the professors and teachers in schools that are part of this program. So trust is being reestablished. I must tell you that some poor parents, for their children, their daughters, to leave the home to go get married, it was a way to avoid poverty. We told them that this is not the right way. It is education and training. The sons of farmers who only recognize themselves in the land, we establish formulas where they understand where they are at. We were able to regroup some 3,000 farmers, people who had no hope of working their parcels of land. The state put 1 billion carrows of land at their disposal, and they started planting bananas. The formula is that they are farmers, but they are also entrepreneurs. The product of the sale of these bananas will come back to them, and they will split it among themselves. So there's some trust being rebuilt from policies and in the state. The idea of the Mexican president to establish this INADEM, the institute that we met today, whose officers we met today, it's important to accompany young people, to give them a space to the state, for example, creates a space to reassure investors, to enable them to come to the country, and creating spaces so that tourists feel secure in Haiti, in the region. So in this trend, it's a result of good governance, and maybe the lack of trust is due to the failure of certain policies. Je revenir à un point que vous avez mentionné dans... Oh, sorry.
Look as a whole. If we look at the world, we see the emergence of regions. We have a certain degree of deglobalization, but we see the emergence of stronger regions. Now, one thing which always strikes me, traveling around the world, Latin America has the best ingredients, if I may say so, parameters to be really an integrated region, a joint culture, only two languages. But if I compare with other regions in the world, for example, we just had a meeting in the ASEAN countries, I still feel a lack of commonality and of common thinking. What is the reason of, why isn't Latin America more integrating? Of course, you have certain progress like the Pacific Alliance and so on, but there is a lack of Latin American integration. What is the reason? Or would you object my observation?
No, a ver, yo creo.
No, undoubtedly, the Latin America region, the Caribbean basin, have a lot of affinities, a culture, language, history that we share, that identify all of us with each other. And I think we've been building among all of the countries of the region, we've been coming closer and to know each other better. But in spite of all of these affinities, it doesn't mean that there's unanimous. There's only one way of looking at things. This is not the case. I think that part of our very evolution is to find diversity, plurality, and those countries, I think, that are closer together, that are, have more affinity, are coming closer together and are working on development and prosperity due to more integration, a more productive situation, more integration, more exchange in different fields. And I think that is the vision under which Mexico is working, precisely how to be more solidary with the countries of the region, with have our own needs, we have our own lacks and wants, and dependent, of course, on our own capabilities, but we can be solidary and to be part of the solidary effort throughout the region. And at the same time, we will have strategic partnerships that are being built for our, in favor of our society. You mentioned something very important, which is precisely the Pacific Alliance. There are four countries, Mexico, Chile, Colombia, and Peru, that form this alliance. We have common values, democracy, economic openness, free trade, and this brings us closer together, and it allows us to build together. And I think it is from this platform that there are other countries in the region that would really like to join us. I believe they're en route to being part of our sub-regional alliance. Mexico is going to continue to foster this, to be faithful to the country's principles and values, and undoubtedly will come closer to other countries of the region who see things the same way. At the same time, Mexico, and this is by a constitutional mandate, and it's a constitutional prescription, is certainly respects free determination so that people can think freely, ideology, and can build the country that they want to be. Mexico will always prove to be open and to be willing to assume and to build together and to be solidary with other countries of the region. I think the Latin American region is undoubtedly one that over the past few decades has had very important structural changes. And I think that the development, the growth, the economic growth, for example, that we've witnessed in this region, social development that we've reached, improvements, that really had come to a standstill some three decades again has now changed, and I will wind up my comments at this time. I think the Latin American region, if we were just one country, we would be the third strongest economy of the world. This is certainly a world of many, a region of many affinities, and undoubtedly we're going to see more development taking place over the next, over the upcoming years, a lot of changes, a lot of reforms. I think each country has its own, and this is going to bring us closer together, and we hope to see more development for the members of our societies. Thank you.
President Varela, would you like to add?
Seguro, profesor. Panamá es un país que va a jugar un papel muy importante en la integración de la región, con su canal, cuya ampliación se culmina en abril del 2016, con sus puertos en plena expansión, con su aeropuerto en plena expansión, con una conectividad a más de 70 ciudades de América, con esa vocación de nuestro pueblo de ser un país de unión.
That vocation of our people to be a people of consensus and dialogue with the presence that's so important of the United States in our region in matters that are so important, such as healthcare and education. And when we see that openness to dialogue, such as the Summit of the Americas and the search for integration and social peace and debates on best practices, I believe that investment is very important because it's also one of the greatest challenges that we have in terms of security. Exchange information on the criminal records of people so that we are able to look into this and to lift the migratory barriers as well. So let's let the good people move and for there to be greater personal mobility of persons, but keep the others back so that we have also a fostering of social networks but let's look at integration for security purposes and keep organized criminals back. But as the president of Panama was saying 6 years ago, was that the most important was to be able to visit 56 countries and to identify how different countries had faced very specific issues. Many countries have had great successes in meeting very specific challenges in infrastructure and mass transit, etc. And that's what integration and dialogue is all about. For a country that takes part in all of these fora, it's a great opportunity for drawing closer ties. And it seems to me that this brings a greater stability and economic prosperity to the region. But I think the most important thing is to set aside ideological differences and to focus on unity in the continent. And this in CELAC, I think, can play an important role. It's historic. For the first time, a united Latin America, we're going to have on June 10th, we're going to have a historic moment in Brussels with bringing together all of Latin America with Europe. There are historical and ideological differences. During World War II, Europe sought peace and the first steps to the European Union. But in this region, it was a great conflict amongst regions. All of this changed. So we're young democracies, 25, 30-year-old democracies that are just beginning to bear fruit. So now we want to become a continent with economic prosperity that seeks peace and that looks for a solution to problems in dialogue. And I think it's very promising for this continent. I think a united American continent will do a great deal for the world in terms of all of the challenges that are being faced in the Middle East and the Far East and Africa, etc. So I think Latin America needs to share best practices and to work jointly to identify the problems of different countries and at summits to deal with important topics in terms of infrastructure, education, although we don't have a final document because the political matters make it very difficult to have a final document for all of the countries. But if we can work from a technical point of view, our technicians for 7 months, those would be important contributions for the multilateral fora to be able to identify jointly what the missions are of each of the countries. I think it's very important from terms of integration to be able to share best practices, the capabilities of companies that have been able to help their countries and the other countries to contribute knowledge to the economic development of all countries. So I think greater integration
will is moving forward. It's moving forward at a good pace, and I think that Latin America is increasingly focusing on its problems and on working together and setting aside any ideological problems, differences that we may have.
Specific challenges each country has to face. And in this context, President Peña Nieto, you have to face this context of criminality in your country. Could you tell us something about how you tackle this very poisonous issue?
Con mucho gusto. Yo creo que primero hay que decir...
Definitely. I think, first of all, you have to say that there is no country in the world that is not facing problems of criminality and crime. There is no country in the world that doesn't have security problems, certainly accentuated in certain areas that are different in each country, and Mexico is not different from that. Perhaps in Mexico for the past few years, Mexico has been stigmatized because of insecurity, perhaps because we are a country in which a great deal of traffic of drugs that comes through in its direction to the largest consumer country, and now those drugs are going to other countries and other regions of the world. But undoubtedly, Mexico, because of its geographic position, the issue of insecurity and criminal organizations tied to drug trafficking, this has all stigmatized Mexico. The question that one would have to ask oneself is whether the policy that the government has defined in this administration to improve security issues so as to have a Mexico of peace and security, the Mexico that we want, whether it's working or not. The answer, I would have to say, is yes. Because at the end of the day, the figures, the statistics speak for themselves. There's less violence. There are less number of murders. There are regions of the country that just a few years ago were experiencing scenarios of huge violence, and today they have different scenarios, very different scenarios. There are visible changes. Ciudad Juarez, for instance, in Chihuahua, the metropolitan area of Monterrey that was facing enormous times of violence, and today, undoubtedly, the situation that they're experiencing is very different. And that's just to point to a couple of areas in the country. I think that we are moving forward. I think this is one of the areas. And I think to answer another part of your question, there are others that were not satisfied, where we believe that the policies that we're instrumenting that consist basically of strengthening institutional capabilities and having greater coordination amongst all bodies of government. This is not just a task for the federal government or the government of the country. It's a task for all bodies of government so as to fight insecurity. But let it not be said that we aren't moving forward. We are, because the figures speak for themselves. There's a decline in kidnappings, extortions, and murders, things that most hurt Mexican society. But we are not satisfied yet. It's clear that there is still much to do. But it's also clear that in this aspiration of having a secure country, there is an unsubstitutable and unrenounceable task of all government, but this implies collaboration of society as well through reporting crimes, through the non-participation or collusion with criminal gangs, and perhaps filing anonymous complaints, if you will. But I think we are moving forward on that, and I would answer your question by saying, yes, it's a great challenge for the government. It's a great challenge for the country, just like any other nation in the world has. I think we're moving forward, even though we are still not satisfied, nor are we ringing the church bells to say we've done it. We are still working on having a Mexico of peace and of tranquility, which is what we want for Mexican society.
Mr. President, as you rightly said, it's not a Mexican problem. It's a global problem. And I think we all have to encourage you in your fight because you need global solidarity. And the outcome of your fight will have global consequences also. We are, unfortunately, at the end of, yes, please.
Just excusez-moi.
Excuse me. I would like to take the opportunity of this platform on the issue of security to tell everybody here that the perception of Haiti that is being sold in the media saying that we have a lot of insecurity is totally false. Our crime rate is of 7 over 100,000. So Haiti is one of the most secure countries of the region. And I remember some 2 or 3 years ago at the summit of CARICOM, the Eric Holder, the U.S. Attorney General, came to Haiti and he was talking about the three most insecure countries of the region, and Haiti was not on the list. So I felt that it was timely to mention this before this audience, because when people think that a country is not secure, they don't go there. And if you'll allow me, on the integration point that you mentioned earlier, I'd like to talk about what President Peña Nieto said on connectivity. I think that's a big weakness of the region. Let's say you take a mango from Haiti that is to be shipped to Bahamas and Trinidad and Tobago. This product must go through Florida to go back down to the Bahamas or transit through a third country. It increases the cost of the product. It removes from its freshness. It's discouraging and does not create commerce. I'd like to underline that in spite of this forum, in spite of the associations we are part of, economic and social inequalities and poverty still remain. I think the time has come to find a particular formula to develop a regional market, a formula, for example, an institution in charge of such a development, an institution that could identify success stories, for example, in ADEM or Frugal Innovations, where a lot is being done with very little. We must find formulas. We must work on connectiveness. And each country of the region should agree to launch one product from each country and create a market. Let's say Haiti sells its beer, and Mexico its guayaberas, and Panama its hats. So we're talking about a market of 250 million people, strictly in the greater Caribbean. So we should take advantage of this platform every year or every 3 years to launch a given product, create markets for more employment, more wealth, more investment, and eventually more stability for the region. And that's the point I wanted to make. Thank you.
To the end of this discussion, and we raised a lot of questions, what politicians should do or what we expect from governments. But I give you now a chance. What do you expect from the many business leaders who are in here in this room? If you just could tell in one or two sentences, what is your expectations towards the business community here? President Varela?
In my case, in Panama's case, we have a road for public-private partnership or work, and we're working on education. There are 3,600 schools in Panama, and we want the schools throughout the country to have this to be of the same level, whether they're private or public. We want the academic level to be the same so as to train the future professionals of our country, so as to be able to take on the jobs created by our economy. The second is social corporate responsibility. This is very important for the private sector in terms of education, for the private sector to take a school, to remodel it, to do what it needs to be done so that its top level will take 30 or 40 days for the private sector to do, whereas it would take 6 months for the public sector. When the private sector comes in, it works on its experience, the experience of its executives. They can take a school and quickly turn it around. And the message that's sent to lower income
quarters of the country is a great message. It's a message that education is everyone's issue. And it means sharing economic development and success. And there's a great impact in terms of jobs, as well as on the schools, because the schools are going to be training the collaborators and the future business persons of Latin America. So I think that education should be a topic for the state in Latin America. Also for stability, politicians are facing elections every 5 years and political forces change. So things have to change as well. So for the private sector to take part in the future of a country's educational system means that there's going to be a state vision and something that's so important, such as education, that'll make a more competitive Latin America, enable our country to reach other levels of efficiency, competition, human development, social development, sustainable development, and social peace. At the end of the day, it will enable the companies to also achieve what they want for the social and prosperity development of our countries. And I think that this would be something that would be very important. We're doing this with 150 companies in our country that are taking active part in 400 Panamanian schools where half of the children go to school. So we're seeing that this public-private partnership working together to improve the state of our schools and having private sector become part of our schools and of our educational system will enable us to move forward in the system and to have equity with the most important tool to seek it, which is, of course, education.
President Varela, you speak out of my heart because the World Economic Forum was just recognized as an official international organization for public-private cooperation. And it expresses our deep beliefs that the challenges internationally and nationally can be best solved through public-private cooperation. Mais, Monsieur le Président, quel est votre message pour les chefs d'entreprise.
Mr. President, what is your message for heads of companies? Just 1 minute to tell you very quickly that what you are told about Haiti is totally false. Haiti is a land of opportunity. If you don't come yourself and experience it, you won't understand it, because often Haiti was sold as a country to be avoided due to its weaknesses. Well, I think it's the absolute opposite. You must visit the country, identify the weaknesses, and look at the opportunities and take advantage of them. That's how Mr. O'Brien, Dennis O'Brien of Digicel, came to Haiti and established Digicel as one of his major businesses. He did the same by establishing the Marriott today. Just to give you an idea of our orientation, we have Marriott, Wilton, Best Western, Delta, JetBlue, Continental. Things are moving in Haiti. We have needs in energy. We are building ports and airports. So come and visit us. We have the Center for Facilitating Investment that will guide you and help you out and assist you. There's a new dynamic where the state protects and defends your investments. So seize this opportunity. Forget what you knew about Haiti in the past and come with a new mindset, with a new way of thinking and of looking at things. We are under reconstruction. We are in the business world today. We want to enter into modernization. So come and visit us, because there's good news in Haiti.
Nieto, I will complicate the situation or your answer a little bit and ask you to have two messages. One for your very prominent business community, local business community, which is here, and one for the international business community.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Professor Schwab. I would say to the community of entrepreneurs and business persons who are here, both of Mexico and from abroad, that, you know, I have one and the same message for both groups. I think Mexico is a country of opportunity. I'd like to say that to them. Mexico is a country in which the government believes in the entrepreneurs of our country. It believes in the business persons of the country. We are a government that
stands not facing our entrepreneurs, but beside them. We want our entrepreneurs to be the soul and the driver of movement in this society. And what the government does is to be a facilitator. It builds opportunities. It opens horizons. It opens roads so that those who have this capacity and this novel attitude, this innovative, constructive attitude, can have space for creativity and for work. In addition to the strengths and possibilities and opportunities that Mexico has built over the years of the opportunities because of its geographic position, its trade opportunities of being a promoter of free trade, this today implies that we are a country that has made structural changes that opens important opportunities for investing in Mexico, and so that global, national, and foreign companies that can grow in Mexico. And this will determinedly contribute to the generation of development and jobs for Mexico. For Mexicans, the structural reforms that have come about in Mexico are a means. They are not an end in and of themselves. They are a means or a platform so that Mexico can generate prosperity and development for its society. And I firmly believe, I truly am convinced that it is our entrepreneurs and business persons from Mexico and from abroad that are all over the world who are the drivers of that development. They are the spirit of growth and prosperity and development of any society. So I would say to them, at the end of the day, know and be clear on the fact that Mexico is a government that's your ally. It is a facilitating government. It is a government that promotes creativity of Mexicans and of anyone who wants to expand and grow in this country. There is no doubt it is a country of opportunity, and you have a future of promising success if you decide to invest in Mexico. So welcome to Mexico.
I would like to thank our panel for the great discussion we had, the encouraging policies they presented to us. I was reflecting how I would summarize the situation of Latin America today, having been here in this region first 40 years ago. At that time, I think Latin America was a region of hope. And then it became a region of promise. But now you are finally a region of realistic opportunities. Ladies and gentlemen, at the end of this session, of our opening session, we always have a small ceremony, and we want to honor social entrepreneurship. We want to honor those who, on the grassroots level, really drive social innovation with an entrepreneurial spirit. My wife, Hilde, and I created a foundation for social entrepreneurship over 15 years ago, when nobody really understood what the term social entrepreneurship means. In the meantime, we have honored more than 300 outstanding examples of social entrepreneurship. And at the end of this opening session, we will honor 4 extraordinary examples of social entrepreneurship from Latin America. They were chosen from over 100 candidates this year. So if you just stay for some minutes, and I will call the social entrepreneurs, the 4 social entrepreneurs here to the podium. See, first, it's a joint effort. Carlos Orellana Aguiar and Javier Orcuizen Urrutia. Please stand up and join me here at the stage. They are the founders of Salano, and they have leveraged their investment banking and the private equity expertise for a truly social purpose. They trained at Aravind Eye Care System in India, by the way, which is another Schwab Foundation honoree. And this organization in India is famous for being the largest provider of vision services in the world. Carlos and Javier adopted Aravind's operating innovations to the Mexican context, allowing surgeons to conduct 10 times more surgeries than a typical ophthalmologist, even while cutting, at the same time, you were cutting per surgery costs by half. In 4 years, it's incredible, in 4 years, Salona has treated 100,000 patients, 40% of which came from households earning less than $75 a month. So what extraordinary achievement. Please accept here this award. I'm now calling on Catalina Escobar Restrepo. Catalina overcame deep personal tragedy to create the Juan Felipe Gomez Escobar Foundation, named in honor of her son. The foundation has directly contributed to reducing the infant mortality rate by 79% in the city of Cartagena in Colombia. The medical center has treated 130,000 patients and saved the lives of more than 4,000 infants and children. Beyond saving infants' lives, part of the foundation's core objective is to provide their teenage mothers with a pathway out of poverty with a set of interventions that is already being replicated in other Latin American countries. Please join me here, Catalina. May I call on Gonzalo Munoz. The World Economic Forum is institutionally committed to accelerating the circular economy because the millions of tons of waste generated each year is old thinking. New thinking is creating economic opportunities out of waste. Trikilos does just that. Gonzalo developed a market-based model to solve the waste problem. Street waste pickers operate 70 recycling stations in Chile and Brazil, where their role is to provide a service to governments and companies and at the same time educate citizens in how to reduce waste. In replicating to Brazil, Trikilos is creating a franchise model for global expansion. And finally, Eduardo Bontempo and Claudio Sasaki. GIKI aims to democratize access to higher education in Brazil by offering free online services for public high school students to prepare for the national merit exams. More than 3 million students across 17,000 schools in Brazil have used GIKI's platform, which harnesses adaptive learning technology and can improve student performance on the national exam up to 30%. And just last week, Eduardo and Claudio finalized a collaboration with one of the largest states, Brazilian states, to cover another 500,000 students by the end of 2015. Having already now your 3 million students which are integrated into your system. Great achievement, congratulations. It shows what innovation can do, and particularly if innovation is directed towards the social needs of population. And we are very proud to have those social entrepreneurs, and there are other ones, honorees of the last years, who are with us. So please join us, and we have, together with the heads of state, we have a group photo to honor you, and this will conclude the session.